Well, hello everybody. It is Stella. It is Friday. I am on live. It's been a long time since I've done a live presentation on a Friday. So I want to say thank you all so much for those people who responded to my post when I said earlier today that we were going to do a live video tonight. So while we're waiting for everybody to come on, I apologize for the little, you know, raspiness in my voice. For about 2 weeks, I've been contending with kind of a nasal ear, nose, throat thingy, but you know, the enemy is a lie. It's not going to stop me from talking. So we're going to do this presentation tonight. And I'm excited because I actually, the name or the subject for this presentation came to me, I was actually doing some research, and we in the Chayil Circle, for those who don't know about the circle, it's a group that I have on Facebook, and it's actually growing probably about 125 people now, but my goal is not numbers. I've been wanting to go through and kind of clean house anyway, but I'm waiting because I realize that a lot of people in the circle were like me. I was like that. When I first started learning truths that were powerful enough to change my life, I was reluctant to jump all in, to give every, to just, you know, go full force behind it. And it took me a while to grow into the full awareness of things like a prosperity mindset versus a poverty mind, being abundance focused, cultivating behaviors and thought systems that allowed me to focus my life from a positive realm instead of a negative realm. And those are just some of the things that are kind of guiding principles in the circle. What is the circle? It is a network of people who are coming together to reinforce each other's eccentric values, focusing on the gifts, the talents, the abilities, and the callings that God has deposited in our lives, and then sort of helping each other go, you know, what's stopping you from doing this? What's stopping you from launching that business? What's stopping you from writing the book? What makes you go back to him every time? What is it? Because until we figure out those kinds of things, we're not going to have the ability to be who we were created to be and to do what God has called us to do. So when I was really working on the presentation or putting together the content for tonight's program, it really struck me that a lot of people don't understand that what happens out here is really nothing more than a reflection of what's going on in here. And if we don't understand what's going on in here and what's making me tick, you will spend your whole life in a reality that you did not choose. You will spend your whole life with a purpose that doesn't belong to you. You will spend your whole life doing things that are neither your preference nor your desire. And we frequently won't even know why we're doing it. You'll be in relationships that will draw out the worst in you instead of being in relationships that celebrate your identity and reinforce the values of who you are, of who God made you to be. Those are the kinds of things that we really want to get down to the bottom of in the circle. Because if you get down to the bottom of this stuff and figure out what is really going on inside of me, if I can know myself, that's what one of the Greek philosophers said, know thyself. If I can know me and understand what makes me tick and what is making me do the things that I do, what's causing me to make the choices that I'm making, if I am making choices and doing things that are inconsistent with who I am and I don't even know why, that's a problem. That's a problem. So there are seven things that you and I have to know about ourselves. There are seven things that we need to do. And so one of the things that I just posted in the circle actually yesterday, and it's going to be a tool so that when people join the tool, join the circle, they're going to have access to a resource, an assessment, a self-evaluation assessment. Though this will be the one of a number of assessments that we're going to make available. Some of them will create, some of them I create, and then some of them I find specialists or people who do this, or I find great resources and we bring it to you so that you can figure out what are, for example, like what are your spiritual gifts? What are your motive gifts? Not only those kinds of things, but we want to talk about more. So let's look tonight at a brief list. And I'm not going to be long. I just want to list these. We're not going to study them tonight. I'm just going to make a list of what they are. Seven things you must know about yourself. Okay? Seven things that you have to know about yourself. The first thing that you need to know about yourself is your identity in Christ. Now, what does that mean? Because there are two sides of you. There is your natural realm persona, and there's your divine realm identity. Your identity in Christ is what empowers you to see yourself through God's eyes. That way, if you see yourself through your identity in Christ, it won't allow, then you'll realize the number two, what your number two is. Your number two is you have to know your worth. Okay, so number one, the first thing you have to know about yourself is, what is your identity in Christ? Do you relate to your life from your identity in Christ? In other words, if you relate to your life from your identity in Christ, when you make a mistake, you won't beat yourself up and shoot yourself in the head and do all of this other craziness. Why? Because when you identify with God, you realize Jesus already took the price for all of that. And then you will start to look at your persona through your identity. Now, your persona is not the same as your identity in Christ. Your persona is you, the package of you that God created when he imagined you in his mind, when he thought about you. He thought certain things, characteristics, abilities, values, things that he wanted to do in your life, that he wanted to manifest for you, okay? So when God thought about you, he sent Jesus to die for you. But then when he created you in your mother's womb, before the foundation of the earth was ever laid, he created you so that you could manifest your persona. Now, once you know your persona and your identity in Christ, now you have a value to know number two. What is your worth? What is your worth? What are you worth? In other words, now, it's not just your worth in terms of your monetary value, even though that's one of them. In fact, I am the persuasion I need to know what is my worth in multiple realms. I need to know what is my worth to the kingdom of God in terms of my ability to overcome and defeat the enemy in the lives of other people. What is my worth in the realm of prayer? Okay? What is my worth? I mean, does the enemy get intimidated when he finds out I'm about to go pray? Or does he go, man, I guess I can take a nap. She ain't gonna say nothing. See, I need to know my worth in my spiritual realm. I need to know my worth in the economic realm. Let's talk about the economic realm. What is your worth? Do you know your intrinsic value to the marketplace? There are people who go to work every day frustrated about how they're being treated on their job. And if they would just update their resume and send it out there and see what kind of money they could get offered, it would change the way they work. It would change their attitudes. It would change how they approach the world. So number one, what is your identity with Christ, which is related to your persona, your identity and your persona? Number two, what is your worth? Not just your financial worth, but let's look at each of the categories of goals. Now, there are seven different categories that you need to know your worth in, okay? That's number two. Number three, you need to know your why. Number three, what is your why? Why are you here? Why do you wake up in the morning? What excites you? Now, your why is tied to several things. Your why is tied to your passions. Your why is also attached to your longings. Passions are what excites you, and longings are what you desire, and you're afraid to talk about because you don't feel like it's possible at some level. So number three is, what is your why? Number four, what are your values? What are your values? What do you stand for? I mean, there's an old quote that said, if you don't know what you stand for, then you'll fall for anything. If you don't know what you'll, if you don't stand up for anything, you'll fall for anything, or something like that. But what are your values? Now, when we say values, we're not just talking about honor and truth and those kinds of things. We're talking about how you relate to the world, what's important to you. I'll give you an example. If one of your values is autonomy or freedom, then you will hate working a job. One of my higher values is, my three highest values are excellence, service, and autonomy. If what I do, I want to do it the best. Number two, I love serving people in some way. And number three, I like freedom. I hate being strapped to a time clock. Why? Because my preference is not to be compensated by a time clock. My preference is to be compensated according to my contribution. I want to know, what difference am I making? My higher values, those are things of excellence, service, autonomy are my top three. But then another one is making a difference, my contribution. What are your values? That's number four. Number five, what are your learning styles? Now, this one is powerful because a lot of people don't get it. When it comes to how you learn, if you don't understand how you learn, or especially if you don't understand how your children learn, your children can be in a school that is absolutely not designed for them. And they can be failing, they can be low achieving, they cannot be mastering what they need to know. Now, there are actually four primary categories of learning styles, but there are actually, some people count as many as seven different learning styles. Now, I'm not going to go into them all here, but I'll just use one, for example, a spatial learner. Spatial means a person who learns through space. Let's say if you're teaching a concept like distance, okay? If you're talking about distance and John traveled from point A to point B, and if you're talking about distance, saying that to a person, just talking it to them, they're not going to get it because that's an auditory, okay? And then drawing it on a chart is a visual. But when you put Johnny in a simulator in a vehicle, and then he gets to put his feet on the gas and he gets to drive, and then he goes at 40 miles per hour, and then he sees that he gets there at 40 miles an hour, it takes him 2 minutes to get to. See, that's a spatial learner. They have to experience it in space, and they're kinesthetic because they have to interact with it. How do you learn? What's your learning style? Okay? What is your learning style? So that's number one, number two, number three, number four, number five. We've covered five. The next one we want to talk about, what are your natural strengths and what are your natural weaknesses, okay? There are some things you just do without thinking. I mean, you know, I can walk up to a bowl, stick my hand in, pull out a phrase and a word. I can look at it and in 15 seconds I can talk about it. Have absolutely no knowledge of it, but that's a gift. I mean, I can talk about it. I can go into a setting, don't know anybody in the room, and in 15 minutes, I can probably tell you 50% of the people in there and know their names. That's a gift of mine. That's a natural gift. Now, what is a natural weakness? A natural weakness of mine is I don't do well when I'm cornered. Okay, I don't like being cornered. When I'm cornered, I have a tendency to do one of three things. One, I'll shut down. Two, I'll run. Or three, I'll try to take you out. But most people don't do well. Everybody has a weakness. So number six is, what are your natural weaknesses and what are your natural strengths? Natural strengths. Now, most people feel like, well, I need to work on my weaknesses. No, you don't. What you need to do is focus on your natural strengths and work on increasing your capacity to function using those natural strengths in unlimited times. Just do them frequently, easily. Build up your natural strengths. And then you need to find other people you can count on to go ahead and build up your natural weaknesses so that you got people watching out for you in the areas where you're weak. That's where great relationships come in. All right, number seven. You need to know your emotional intelligence score and what level of emotional intelligence you have moved, that you are functioning. Now, there are four categories of emotional intelligence, okay? There are four categories, but they're like four levels. One of them, or the primary levels, is self-awareness. Self-awareness is knowing what I am feeling emotionally, how the environment is affecting my emotions, and then how am I reacting or responding to it. So what I'm doing, when I'm doing stuff, what am I doing, and how is what I'm doing, how is the environment affecting me? How am I translating this experience in my mind so that I can be effective regardless of the conditions that are going on around me, okay? So those are seven. Now, are there other things that you should know about yourself? Yeah, there are a lot. There are actually a number of others. I'm not going to go over all of them. I'm going to leave it at those seven levels. Now, I'm going to stop this teaching right here because I've just listed seven things that you need to know about yourself. Let's review them. And Bianca, thank you so much for going over these with me. We're going to look at those seven things. Number one, you need to know your identity in Christ, which is associated with your persona. Your persona is who you are. When God thought of you in his mind, he had an idea about certain gifts, talents, knowledge, abilities, okay? So that he put those in you. He deposited them inside of you. And he made you unique and special. That's your persona. Your identity is who you are in Christ, so that you can access your persona and maximize it without the limitations of sin telling you what you can't do, who you're not. You're not, if a young person tries out for the play and they don't get it, that doesn't mean you're any less valuable. Your identity in Christ will give you the confidence to say, I'll just go try it for the next one. I'll go try it at the next event or whatever. Your identity in Christ reminds you that who you are does not hinge on what you do, on how pretty you are, on how smart you are. None of those things determine your value. Your value is based on your identity in Christ. You are God's beloved. He loves you. Number two thing you need to know about yourself is, what is your worth? We're not just talking about your economic worth, but we're talking about your, what is your social worth? Here's another one. People have no social skills. And so, you know, I once knew an older man, and he was very, very lonely. He's very sad. And I was talking to him. I said, well, let's play some cards. I don't know how to play cards. I said, okay, let's play dominoes. I don't know how to play dominoes. I said, okay, you don't know how to play dominoes. You don't know how to play. Let's play Uno. You know, just find this, trying to find something I could do with him to kind of help him be engaged. He didn't know how to play anything. And I said, well, no wonder you're lonely. You don't fish. You don't play any games. You know, well, who gonna want to be around you? You have no social skills. Now, I'm not making light of that. I'm just using that as an example. You need to know your worth, and you need to know your worth in multiple categories: your social worth, your emotional worth. You need to know your relational skills. In other words, when you show up, what else, what value is there in you that you bring to the table? When you show up, what comes to the table? When you show up, what comes to the table? That's why it's important to know your worth, so that if you're thinking about being involved in a mastermind alliance, everyone has something to bring to the table. You need to know, what do you bring to the table? What's your worth? When you show up, what comes to the table? Number three, what is your why? That is your passion-focused desires and your longings. Your passion is what you're excited about, and your longing is what you're hungry for. Number four, things you need to know about yourself. What is your value? What are your values? What matters to you? Number five, what is your learning styles? Number six, what are your natural strengths and weaknesses? And number seven, what is your emotional intelligence score? What level are you functioning at emotionally? So those are just seven. Now, are there more? Absolutely. But I'm not going to talk about those on here. I'm going to talk about those inside the Chayil Circle. For those of you who are not familiar with the Chayil Circle, let me talk about it one more time. It is a Facebook group that we've put together. And we're going to be doing things about helping people understand, what is a mastermind? What is a mastermind alliance? What is a hub? These are people, if you are a high-functioning person, or you want to be a high-functioning person, you're going to need help to do that. And that's what we're doing in the circle. We have some great testimonies that are starting to manifest. We invite you to come and join us. That's what the Chayil Circle is. Now, this Sunday night, we have a class that's going to be inside the circle, and it's called What is Wisdom? We're going to look at the elements of wisdom. A lot of people think wisdom is having good counsel from people, but wisdom is so much. Wisdom has levels, wisdom has depth, and wisdom has breadth. And you need to know what each of those things are and how can you use them to be more effective in the earth. That's all I got to say on this one, you guys. Thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Thank you. I appreciate your being here with me. And until we meet again, you make it a terrific day.